the structure. So I'll be revising the concept once again. So this, once we have the different data types or different variables which are related with each other, say for example, date, month and year, that is D, M and Y. So these three are integer variables and they are collectively representing what? They are collectively representing one single date of the year. That is, these are the three integers which are representing the date. And we know that these three entities are related with each other. These three entities are related with each other. Combinedly, they are going to represent one entity. So in such situations, what we can do here is we can go for structures. We can go for structures. If we have defined a function called next day, any given day, if you want to find next day of that function, obviously it is going to affect each and every entity. It is possible that when you increase the date, month will also get increased, then year will also get increased. Suppose T is 1 and M is 1. That means first day of January 2002. And if you find the next day of that particular year, if you find next day of that particular year, next day will become 2 and month will be 1 and year will remain as it is, 2002. Because after 1-1-2002, the next day is 2-1-2002. That is very obvious. But the relation will be something different when the concept is something like this. D is 28, M is 2 and year is 1999. That is, date is something like this. 28, 2 and 1999. In this case, if you find next day for this, so what happens? When you try finding next day, we know that the number of days, it is representing 28th February 1999. So in the 1999, after 28, we don't have 29. That means we should be able to change the month. What happens? Next month will become 1st March 1999. That means in this case, what has happened? The next day has impacted both the date value and the month value. The next day has impacted both the date value and the month value. So that is how these components are related with each other. So let us take one more example. So what is this date? Date is 31-12-1999. That is, date is 31-12-1999. That means December 31st. And we know that obviously after December 31st, January 1st will come. So when you execute the next day function on this, so what do we get? We get 1-1-2000. In this case, what has happened? The date entity, the month entity, and the year entity, all three have been changed in the next day. So all have got changes. So that is how they are related. That is how they are related. These components are related. If one entity is changing, that may impact or affect other entities also. So that is how they are related. So when we have such related entities, it is better practice to combine them into single entity. It is better practice to combine them into single entity. So that is why we need the structures. So how we can combine them? We can define a structure data type. That is, define a structure data type by using struct keyword and give it a name called date. So any other name you can give, but as we are dealing with dates, let us give the suitable name called date itself. Right? So date structure is being defined with the integer entities of date, month and year. So this is going to define a structure. A structure is being defined with the members called D, M and Y. Now it will be easy for us to manipulate all the components. Means you can declare the variables of the structure. How do we declare variables of the structure? Using struct keyword, using name of the structure, and then name of the variable. What this will call? This will declare a structure variable. This will declare a structure variable. It's going to declare a structure variable. What happens whenever it declares a structure variable with this entity? This entity, a structure variable will be declared with the members reserved for each and every member. What is the name of the structure variable? D1 is name of the structure variable. What are the members of the structure? D, M, and Y. They will get the memory, individual memory reserved. Then for understanding purpose, next day is the method. This next day method is a data member which can access this year, month, and date. Which can access that year, month, and date. But that is why we need the structures. Right, how can we create a new data type using structures? So we have seen that structures are essential for combining or joining the related pieces of information together and store them into the memory. So that is what it was the need for structures. And it is better practice to combine the related entities together and manipulate them. How can we create a new data type of our own? That means instead of using the available data type, you can also create your own data type. So what are the different steps? First thing is put the structure definition and prototype of the associated functions in a header file. That means create your own header file. The first step is you have to create your own header file. So what specific name it is being taken here? The name is being taken as date.h. Here you can give any other name also. You are free to give any other name also in place of data.h. So this is a file which is going to contain structure definition along with the prototypes of the functions. So as usual, we have defined the structure. Structure definition is defined as the structure in the date.h header file. And along with the prototype, what are the prototypes? We are giving prototypes for two different functions here. What is first function? The first function is intended for providing next day of the present date. Whatever present date you give now, it will provide the next day. Another function is written for a better understanding. Just get the system date. These two are the function prototypes. We'll be defining these functions later. And in the comment it is written here, what is that? Prototype of other useful functions can be defined later. We are free to define whatever we want because user is creating his own data type. We are creating our own data type here, right? So instead of this DMY, you are free to define any other variables also. This is one sample they have taken in this case, right? Next step is what? Step two. Put the definition of the associated functions in a source code and create a library. So whatever the associated functions you have, that is, and the prototypes of which you have written in the structure definition, they must be written in a source code, and we have to create our own library. So this is what you can give any other name, but they have given for understanding purpose date.c as the file name. Include this header file. If you remember, usual practice what we do when we are starting the programming, we write statement like hash include stdio.h. Hash include stdio.h. This is what we do usually. Now here what we are doing, just now we have created our own header file. What is that? We have created date.h and we are including that in our program. I will go back and show you the date.h header file. So just now we have created this. We created this header file. So what we are doing, we are trying to include this header file in our program. So that's why we have written the statement called hash include date.h. I want to include my own header file here. And there is a difference between including within angle bracket and within double quote. If you write within double quote, the header file will be observed or searched in the present directory. And that is standard directory. In hash include in the angle bracket, it will be searched in the entire library. That is the difference. In both ways, it will work. So this is the definition of the next day function. You are free to define. That is, write the code for calculation of the next date. Write the code for calculation of the next day. That is, you can write statement d equal to d plus 1. D equal to d plus 1 based on the month value. Based on the month value, you can write your own code. That means if it is January month, we know that if D is equal to 31, if you perform D equal to D plus 1, it should not become 32, because maximum number of days in any given month is, it should not become 32, it is 31st. Then obviously it should get a value of 1. So that logic you can define here. We are free to define the logic in this law. Similarly, for system date, you can write the logic. So we have created our own data type and we have included that in the program. Likewise, we can create whatever data type we want. So the third step is provide the header file and library to the programmers. You can share this header file and the library with other programmers. That means you can share your own file, this date.c file you can share. You can reuse, in the sense other programmers can use, and other programmers can also use date dot h. What we have created just now, we have created an header file called date dot h and then date dot c. These two you can share with others. So that they can use it in their programming. Similarly, we can use structures in our programming. This is one sample example how the structures are being used. That is, I'll just give the demonstration. The explanation, that is, how can we use structures in the application programmers. The very first step is, this is just extension of this whatever concept we have studied just now. Just include the header file provided by the library programmer in the source file. What header file we have created just now? We created an header file called date.h. Just include that date.h and write the statements for the main function. The main function, you declare variables, call the functions, get back the return values, and all that logic will be writing within the main function. The second step is to declare variables of the new data type in the source code. That means, what was the new data type? Struct date was a new data type. Declare variables of that type. See here. Declare variables of the new data type in the source code. So this is what is our source code. And what is the name given for that? Name given for that is dateUser.c. In this dateUser.c, in this source file, we are creating variables of the new data type. That is struct date d. So you are free to create any number of variables. You can write with your own name also. That is struct date Rakesh. You are free to give any other names also. That means we can declare variables now. We are going to declare the variables, whatever we need. That is end of the source file. So once we have created your source file, now you have to write definition for the functions. That is what is happening in the third step. Our third step says, embed calls to the associated functions by passing these variables. That means call the functions by passing these variables, whatever we have created in the step two. So that is how it is shown here, how we can embed call. The structure variable is declared as it is. Then you perform some initialization for those. You perform some initialization for those structure variables. I'll read that once again. When you write struct D, when you write struct date D, it is going to create a new structure variable called D, and the memory will be reserved for each and every individual members. What are the individual members of the structure? D, M, I, Y. Then for next day function, symbolically I am just showing you, this is the location for next day function, which is taking address of this entire structure variable itself. Now what is happening in this statement? The date member of the structure D is getting a value of 28. That is D dot D is equal to 28. Then D dot M. D dot M is equal to 2. Then D dot Y equal to 1999. D dot Y is equal to that. One second. It is assuming it is taking the selection probably. No, it will take 1999, this member. Right, this is how then you call the definition of the function called next day. When you call function, definition of the function called next day. We dot dot indicates we are free to write any other statements in the program. Step four is just compile the source code to get the object file. Compile and then execute the file in the next step, that is step number five. In step number five. Now let us see the procedure-oriented programming and object-oriented programming system. So this has been already covered in the preliminary classes, so I may have to skip this part, but I'll just revise it once. So what happens in the procedure-oriented programming? The more stress is given on actual procedure or code. That means in procedure-oriented programming, procedures are totally separated from the data. That means there is no proper security for the data. So I think I had given one example. When D is equal to 31, at any given point of time, there is possibility that the date can become 32. That is, some other malicious code can manipulate it and bring it to 32. It will be difficult for us to find the data and properly manage the data. So that is the drawback with this programming pattern, is that data is not secure. Data is not secure. It can be manipulated by any procedure. As I said, it can be manipulated by any procedure. So there is a lack of security. There is a lack of security for the data. Right? So that is the problem with the procedure-oriented programming. Say, for example, that's what I told. The month value D dot M, that is the month member, may become 13 at any given point of time. But in fact, we know that the month variable can change from 1 to 12 because there are only 12 months in a year. We don't have more than 12. So it should not become 13. So that is the problem with the procedure-oriented programming. So in fact, how do we provide security for the data? By using classes. That is what we do in case of object-oriented programming system. What happens in object-oriented programming system? We are going to wrap up the data and code together, which is going to operate on that data. That is what is object-oriented programming. So I had given examples of classes and all. That is, how can we combine the data into, that is, how can we define data members and member functions. So I hope just for briefly, I will try to revise. I think I had given this diagrammatical explanation. Data is present here. And then there are functions. There are functions. I think I had given example of house also. This data can only be accessed by these functions. This data can only be accessed by these functions. These functions can only access the data. But outsider cannot access the data. That is how we provided security for the data in case of object-oriented programming. The features of object-oriented programming we have already studied. What is that? Data encapsulation, inheritance, and polymorphism. There are three basic entities, and here they are specified only two. The third one will be mentioned later. What is inheritance? What is encapsulation? Wrapping up of data or combining data and functions together into a single entity is called as encapsulation. That is, example is class, what we have already studied. What is inheritance? Is a mechanism. It is a mechanism with which one class acquires properties from other class. That is, object 2, then object 1. Object 2 can acquire properties from object 1. Then it is called as inheritance. Then it is called as inheritance. What is polymorphism? Single interface which is being used for more than one purpose. So an example whatever I gave was, that is, add function being called with a different set of parameters. Add of a comma b, then add of a comma b comma c. That is three functions. The name of the interface is same here in both the cases, but it is taking different set of parameters. That is how we provide polymorphism. Another example was to call the push function of a stack depending on the number and type of parameters. Push function for integer, it is different. Push for character, it is different. So depending on the type of data, the different stack definitions will be called. That is how we provide polymorphism, right? And the comparison between C++ and C, I think so many differences I have told till now. Basically in C and C++, the difference here is we'll be having data classes in C++, whereas there are structures in C. That is, class keyword is being used in C++ instead of structure. And we are going to introduce two new keywords, that is private and public in C++. So apart from data members, class constructor also has member functions. That means we also have data members and member functions in C++. We'll be studying everything in detail. And one special type of function, what is already known to us, a function which has same name as that of the class, that is called as a constructor. What is the job of the constructor? Constructor is going to initialize the object whenever you create objects of a class. That is what is job of the constructor. And so many other differences we'll be learning as the course will be studied. Now let us see how do we perform console input and output in case of C++. So I think this was explained in the previous example classes in while during the bridge course of C++. So this is the source file. I'll briefly revise it once again. This was the source file. And we have included iostream.h header file. What is the name of the source file? cout.cpp. cout.cpp. And the name of the header file which we are including is iostream.h. Like how in C we include stdio.h. We are going to include stdio.h in C, that is standard input output.h. And likewise we have iostream.h in C++, that is input output stream dot h. This is input stream will always connected with the keyboard and output stream is always connected with the monitor. Now within the main function we have declared an integer variable called x and assign a value 10 to that x and display by using cout statement. Cout is a function which is always related with the output stream to display output onto the screen. Like how we use printf, how we use printf in C to display the values, we use cout in C++. That is, whatever value is present in that will be displayed onto the screen. So for giving explanation diagrammatically, whenever you write x equal to 10, x is a variable, some memory will be reserved for that. In the next statement, what I am doing, x equal to 10. So 10 will be stored in that location. Then cout 10, that is refer to the output stream and display the value present in X. So what will be displayed onto the output? Onto the output, 10 will be displayed. Onto the output, 10 will be displayed. That was one example for the cout. And specifically about this symbol, this is nothing but a left shift operator. That is left shift operator in C, but in C++, it has some special meaning. We are going to overload this left shift operator in C++. And we are going to overload it and we are giving some special meaning. When this operator is inclusively used with cout statement, its meaning will change. When it is used with cout, it will become the output operator. That is nothing but it becomes an insertion operator. Insertion operator, and that is usually related with the keyboard, with the monitor. Display the output onto the screen. And why we should include this header file here is the definitions for that cout and cin statements are present in that iostream.h. Like how the definitions of printf and scanf are present in stdio.h, we should include this header file. And another line here is endl. That endl is very similar to backslash n in C. That is terminate the display there and go to the next line. This is one more program in which x and y two variables are declared. X is assigned with 10, y is assigned with 20. Then display x, endl means go take the cursor to the next line, then display y. That means x will be displayed first. First display x equal to 10, then cursor will go to the next line, then 20 will be displayed. So what basically endl does, it is going to insert a new line at the end. It's going to insert a new line at the end. Now insertion operator, what it does here is it works with different set of values also without using format specifier. If you see in C what we do, to display the integer value, we use a format specifier %d. To display the character, we use %c. For float, we use %f. For all these, for any of the formats, cout makes use of the single statement, that is left shift operator. It's primarily, it's basically working with all type of data types. So different types of variables are declared here. Integer variable, character variable, floating point type of variable, double variable, and character variable. And for all those variables, we are assigning some initial values. 10 to integer variable, x to character variable, then floating point variable will get 2.3, then double will get some value, then character pointer. We are going to store a set of characters in that starting from that pointer memory location. What is that value we are storing? Hello world we are storing here. And finally, what we are trying to display, see here for all the variables, this insertion operation will work equally. We are not going to specify any of the format specifiers here. Just display integer variable, then endl, character variable, endl, that means take the cursor to the next line, floating point variable, next line, double variable, next line, character array, then next line. So that is what we are doing. It fits with each type of data type without a requirement of specifying the format specifier, which we specify in C. So this is how the output looks like. X, 10, 2.3, 3.14, 1.9, and hello world. So that is the speciality of the C++. That means what is the entity which you have to take out from this program? We no need to specify the format specifier for cout statement in C++. Whereas in C, we need to specify the format specifier. You can also assume this one as also as the difference between C and C++. So many differences we go on learning between C and C++. Now, the C++ can also work as cascade operator. So cascade in the sense, in one statement, you can write all this. You can, in one statement, you can display more than one value. That is, x is declared as integer variable, y as floating point type of variable, then 10 we are assigning to x, then 2.2 is assigned to Y. And by using single cout statement, we can display the output in a cascaded manner. That is, display X, then NDL, take the cursor to the next line, then display Y. And we'll get the same output. What is that? 10 and in the next line, 2.2. 10 and in the next line, 2.2. Any number of cascadation you can do. That means after displaying X, Y, then you can display one more variable Z, then PU, then Q, then R. It is possible. That is called as cascading notion of the insertion operator. Right. Now another example here is the cout statement can display the mixed type of values, not only integers, not only character, like how the printf can display multiple values with format specifiers. And a single printf can use percentage d format specifier for displaying integer. Printf can use percentage f for displaying floating point value. Same way, it is possible for cout statement to display directly number 10, in the next line character array, then again the floating point value. That is possible. That's what it is doing. Display 10, hello world, and 3.4. Remember, directly the values can also be displayed by using cout. Directly values can also be displayed by using cout. Without the variable names also, you can display the values. That is one more specialty of the cout statement. Then coming to console input, how we can read the input from the keyboard. Like how we use scanf in C++, in C, by using corresponding format specifier, and we'll be storing the value in specified variable at the address of some variable. That is how we use scanf in C. Now in C++, it is cin which is going to do that work. Cin stands for C input. That means it is connected with the input stream. The basic input stream for C++ is fundamental input stream is keyboard, because we are going to provide input from the keyboard. It is related with the keyboard. I'm just speaking more than half an hour. Are we connected? Can someone respond? Are you understanding? Is there a synchronization between audio and video? Are the things proper? Can someone respond?
Yes, sir.
That's right. Good. Because from our end, the things will be clear, but we cannot say what is happening from the other end. So usually I'll be taking some acknowledgement from you from time to time. Right. So what's how scene works? We are declaring an integer variable called X, and then we are asking user to enter the number. Then that entered number will be stored in a variable X. Entered number will be stored in a variable X. So I'd have given a practical demonstration for each and every program. The programs are ready, but the thing is, if I start that Visual Studio also, some of the programs while giving, if I start this application also, what happens? The system becomes very slow, because in the morning class, my system was it was stuck and I had to reinstall some of the applications. That was the problem. So wherever it is very much essential for some of the programs, I will give you the demonstration. These fundamental things you can understand. It will just ask for the user to enter a number, and that number will be stored in the variable x, and then display it as it is. That is, we have entered, you have entered x. How the output will be displayed? You have you entered colon what 10, if you have entered 10. So for example, this is how the output will be given. Enter a number, then you have to type 10 and then press enter key. Then what it will display? It will display output like, you have entered value 10. You have entered value 10. Is there any problem? No. So all of you mute your microphones. Rishikesh, Pujar, mute your mic. Okay. And this is what is C in and C out. And the scene statement can also be used for reading different type of data without specifying the format specifier. Like in C, if you want to scan interior data, percentage D comma and A, this is how we write. What it indicates? We are reading integer data and storing at the address of A. If you want to read floating point type of data, how do we write? Scanf percentage F, then store at the address of A. This is what is the normal syntax what we write. This is what is the normal syntax what we write in case of C. That is different formats. For integer, you have to specify the format specifier, that is percentage D. For floating point, the format specifier is percentage of that. This is how we should write in C. Whereas in C++, we no need to specify the format specifier by using scene statement. That means when you want to read a whole number, that is possible to read a whole number. That is directly, it will be stored in integer variable. Character, yes, then also it will be stored in a character variable. Real number, it will be stored in a real number variable. Because see, we have declared only the variables here. What are the variables? Integer variable, character variable, and floating point type of variable. Here you are entering integer variable, here you are entering character, and here you are entering floating point type of data. And finally, they are being displayed what? You have entered this integer, this character, and this floating point number. This integer, so character, and floating point number. That is, whole number you have entered as 10, character as x, and a real number as 2.3. Real number as 2.3. One second. Let me check whether I can give some demonstrations. Right. So this one, what I'll do, scene1.cpp, if it is available here. Because demonstrations, I prefer giving demonstrations because they will help you to memorize the subject properly. Help you to memorize the subject properly. I'll time. The machine supports or not, that I don't know. Still, I'll try. Just add an existing program to the solution explorer. One. name on node.cpp is there. I'm going to follow the program. Just copy it. And this is what the problem I face when I try to give demonstrations. The system becomes very slow. Scene 1.cpp, right? Because there are some people are telling that there are issues with the C. That's why I want to give the demonstration. Yes, this is the program. That's not what I explained. The single, it will display a message saying that enter the whole number, store it in an integer variable. Character number, store it in a character. Real number, store it in a floating point type of variable. And what is the output? Integer, next line, character, next line, and floating point variable. I'll just run the program. Program is being executed. Right? So it is asking us to enter a whole number. Right. I kept it aside for understanding. This is the program what I am trying to execute. Right? So enter a whole number. Let us give the value as 10. I'll enter 10 and I'll go to the next line. Enter a character. So any character you can use, say X. Then enter a real number. What is that real number? It could be 2.3. So how it is displaying? You have entered 10. And cursor will go to the next line. So what is the code here? Code is like this. You have entered, display it as it is, then we'll display 10 here. That is integer variable will be displayed. Followed by character variable and followed by floating point type of variable. Press any key to continue. Yes. Did anyone notice any difference? Can you tell me the difference between this program and whatever I have written, even after looking at the output? If you are observing carefully, you will be able to tell. Has anyone observed the difference between this, whatever it is written, and whatever I have executed program?
New lines.
Yes, new line character is being used in this one. So what actually this program is, here it is trying to display in the same line. One space is being given here. Only one space is being given here. But in this program, what I have executed, I have tried to give the new line character. Just for displaying the output properly, one new line character is given. In place of new line character, if you give simply one space, then also it will work. That means the output will be displayed on the same line. Right. I hope you're following the things. Okay. Let's go to the next part of one more example for insertion operator. That is cascading extraction is also possible. Like how the cout can display multiple values on the same line. Like cin can also do that in the same line. That is cin enter two numbers. The first number will be stored in X. The second number will be stored in Y. So that is also possible with the cin also. That is possible with the cin statement also. So remember, cin is always called as extraction operator. Cout is also called as insertion operator. C in extraction, that means it will get the input from the keyboard. C out insertion, it will display output onto the screen. Now variables in C++. So this, if you remember what happens, in C, you should declare variables at the beginning of the program. Whereas in C++, you can declare variables wherever you want. That is one more difference between C and C++. If it is a C program, you have to declare all the variables at the beginning. If it is a C++ program, you can declare wherever you want. You can see here, X is a variable which is declared. Then we have assigned value 10 to that. Then we are displaying it in the third line. And we are declaring one more variable here. That is, declaring a variable in the middle of a function is possible in C++. It is allowed in C++. It is not allowed in C programming. It's not allowed in C programming. Variables in C++.cpp and variables in C.cpp. There are two source files. Let me check whether those source files are available here so that I can give you the demonstration. Variables in C is there, but no, it is not properly compiled. It will take time now. Yes, one second, I'll try to show you. So that you can remember. Variables in C dot C, variables dot these two source files. I'll just try to copy and then one second. I'll remove this file. Then we may have to add one existing file. It will not give any error in C++, because if you need, then only you declare the variables. Don't unnecessarily declare the variables, and those don't waste the memory. So that is what is intention here. That is what is intention in C++. C++ allows us to declare variables wherever we want. Whereas C, it is essential to declare the variables in the beginning of the program. Let us see variables in C++.cpp. I'm just trying to add that program, add a source file to the program. Solution Explorer. It will take some time, but the things will be clear to the maximum extent. Right, source file, that whatever source code I have explained just now, that I have added to the Solution Explorer. I'm just trying to run the program and show you. That is, somewhere after one executable statement, we are free to declare one more variable. Whereas in C, before any of the executable statement works, you should declare all the variables here only in the beginning. That is what is the restriction for C. But in C++, there is no restriction. That is one more strong fundamental difference between C and C++. In C, all the variables must be declared in the beginning. In C++, you can declare the variables whenever and wherever you want. That flexibility is provided. Because this is a very small program, but while working in real life, what happens? The programs will be having thousands together lines or lakhs together lines. Then you may require, while developing, at some point of time, you may need that, you may need one more variable. Then immediately you can declare there and develop the programs. So the value of X is this one, address of X is this one, and press any key to continue. So it is going to display the address. Why? Because save in the source file, PTR is a pointer. We all know what is a pointer. Pointer is a variable which stores address of another variable. And basically for this pointer variable in this statement, what we are trying to do, we are trying to assign the address of X to IPTR and we are trying to display IPTR. So it is displaying the pointer value. Now let us try to just check whether it works in C or not, because source file is not written. I have just slightly modified it. In C, we'll just try to show, and we are expecting error here. We are expecting error variables in C. The same program is written in C now. It's the same program is written in C now. What I'm trying to do here is, I had just commented it to show the proper output. I'll just remove this comment now. So what we are doing in this, see here, it is variables in C dot C. What is the type of the file here? This one. This is a C file. Right? It is, the extension is dot C. The earlier program was having extension of dot CPP. That means that was C++ file. Now in C file, I'll just try to compile and run the program. And we have got the error message. So it shows error in some line. So what is that error? Error, it shows that declaring a variable in the middle of a function is not allowed in C, because you have written the C program. Now I'll just comment that line and show you the execution once again. I'll just comment that line. I have commented that line and I'll run the program once again. Now you can see the program output. Yes, program is executing properly. That is, in C program, you should not declare the variables in between. Whereas in C++ program, you can declare variables wherever you want. I hope this demonstration was helpful, just to know this concept. What is the simple outcome take away from this explanation? In C, you have to declare all the variables in the beginning of the program. In C++, you can declare the variables wherever you want. That is, in between the function also, you can declare in C++. That was the takeaway from this particular concept. Reference variables in C++. I think I'm speaking. So shall I cover this part or shall we take it to the next class? Now it's time is over, because in these online classes it is good not to speak for a long time, because this is your third hour already. So what I will do, I'll stop the class now. One second, don't leave the class. I'm just taking your attendance. Meanwhile, if you have any questions to be asked, you can ask. But still, I'm telling you, don't panic. You will understand the subject, even if you're not understanding. Completing the first module is very much essential. It's very interesting and easy to learn.